The following program is brought to you by Caltech.
Now we get to the heart of the program, and let me first introduce Ed Stone, the Morse Roe Professor of Physics here at Caltech. He's also a member of the board of the Keck Foundation, and he was either the chair or the vice chair of the CARA board. CARA is the organization that actually operates the Keck Observatory for 25 years from the beginning. So, and Ed is going to talk about the beginning of the Keck Observatory. So, Ed.
Well, thank you, Tom. It's really a great, it's been a great experience, I can tell you, to have been involved with a project like this. It's really been an enormous success, and Jim reflected on how successful it was from the standpoint of the foundation as well. So, but it was a bold step, there's no question. That's one theme you'll see. This was a bold beginning that we started on back in 1985. Now, it really got started in 1983. This is the Palomar telescope. You can see it over there on the wall. In 1983, when I became the chair of physics, math, and astronomy, the job that Tom now has, one of the questions is, what's the future of astronomy at Caltech? For 35 years at that time, this had been the premier telescope in the world. But it was very clear there was technology being developed that was going to admit for the first time in 35 years, and maybe 45 or 50 years, that in fact there would be larger telescopes. And the question for Caltech is, what was its situation going to be 10 or 15 years from 1983? So Gary Neugebauer, who was then the director of Palomar Observatory, and the astronomers got together and started looking at what the options were. And there were large disks that Roger Angel was making with a new technology, but all of these relied on computer control to support these much larger mirrors. And there was the segmented mirror, which in fact Jerry Nelson had been developing at Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory. Funded internally by money from the UC president, David Saxon at the time, starting in 1977. This was one of the two major new technologies which was eventually going to result in a telescope that would finally surpass Palomar. And one of the key issues was, if you make this big mirror out of many small segments, 36 segments in the case of the Keck telescope, how do you polish these segments when they're no longer nice spheres? So, you know, it's a spherical segment that's easy to polish. You just put it on a table and polish away, and you end up with a nice spherical surface, at least in principle. But it's doable, and it's done quite often. But how do you polish a piece of glass which goes over on the side of a mirror where it's not, it's an A-sphere? And so Jerry's, and Terry Mast was working with Jerry. Their innovation was to bend the piece of glass, which is about this thick. You can see all the levers around the outside edge. And you put enough weights in the proper way so that you bend this thing, you polish a sphere, and then you release the levers, and it warps back into the shape you really wanted. Sounds hard. Yes, and everybody else in the world thought it was too hard, actually. But in fact, that was a key, number one key thing, and because of the funding, they actually demonstrated they could actually do what's called stress mirror polishing. Another key thing, though, is you have this very thin piece of glass, and you have to support it in some way that the support itself doesn't bend the glass, because we're talking about fractions of a wavelength of light. So they developed this very complex wiffle tree system, which was designed so that, in fact, it would support a mirror on 36 thin stainless steel rods, which themselves were flexible enough so that the harness itself would not bend the mirror. Another key step was to cut the thing into a hex once all this work had been done. And that was, in fact, in the end, the most difficult part, because this glass, once you cut the 6 ears off to make a hexagon, internal stresses warped it again. But you'd already finished all your polishing, so there were various ideas, but in fact, at the time that the grant was given, this was an unsolved problem. We were confident there would be a way to solve it, but in fact, it was not yet solved. So this was the telescope in 1983 that UC was pursuing, the model of it. There's one out in the lobby you can see. The mirror is 10 meters across, 33 feet across. And you can see some small little models of humans there to give you a sense of scale. And the UC had actually gotten a promise of a grant of $36 million from the Hoffman Trust for the Hoffman Telescope. And UC, we had been looking around, talking to the different possibilities, and UC said, yes, we'd be interested in having Caltech join them for $25 million for a 25% share in this new telescope. And so we went to the board of trustees at that time. It was Wall Sargent and I went to the board. Robbie Vogt, of course, as a provost, was a key person in this, and Murph Goldberg, the president, in presenting to the board this idea that we would become part of this 10-meter telescope as a minority partner with UC. And on the board at that time, it turned out, was Howard Keck. The Keck family had had a member of the Caltech board for a number of years. It had been William Keck II, who was on the board before. This is Howard Keck, another son of the W.M. Keck that set up the foundation. And he was on the board at the time, heard the presentation, and Goldberger, of course, approached the Keck Foundation, and the answer was no. 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 And so, but then after a short period of time, there was another interaction where Keck came back and said, but we would be interested in the Keck telescope if we could provide you with $70 million. So suddenly, what started out as completing the funding for the Hoffman telescope became funding for 80% of the funding we needed for the Keck telescope. That was a very bold thing for the foundation to have done, because nobody had ever built a telescope like this before, and you would not know that you could succeed until you had built it. There's no way to simulate this thing on a small scale and feel that you had obviously done it on the scale you needed to build it. So it was a very bold step. It was a very bold step as well for Caltech, because the Board of Trustees agreed, having received only 80% of the funding, to take this on. So Vogt and Goldberger had a series of interactions with UC as to how to do this for a while. They were in fact then designed twin telescopes, one which would be the Hoffman telescope and the other would be the Keck telescope. It turned out that eventually the Hoffman money did not in fact happen, and we had just the Keck telescope as what was announced in January of 1985. And it was, as I say, it was a bold both on the part of the foundation, I think bold on the part of Caltech, to sign up to do this, having raised only 80% of the funding. Well, the next step to this was to get a project manager. And that's Jerry Smith. He was a JPL, Caltech employee at JPL, had worked on Voyager imaging system back in the 70s when I first met him. Then he went on to build the NASA infrared telescope facility on Mauna Kea, right next to where the Keck telescopes are. It's an infrared telescope, about a 3-meter mirror, as I recall. That was 1977. And then he went on to be the project manager for the infrared astronomy satellite, which was launched in 1983. And Tom Seufer did a lot of work with data coming back from that, the first infrared telescope to survey the infrared sky. So here is a person who clearly was qualified to manage this project, to build a telescope nobody had ever built before. So it made a lot of world press. The Los Angeles Times, of course, the New York Times had a long article about it about a month later, the largest grant ever made for such a telescope, and also put it in the context of the other technologies that were being pursued at that time as well. So here was groundbreaking in September of 1985. The pu'u, the cinder cone, had been leveled off for the pad. You can see the shovels there. The telescope you see back here is the NASA Infrared Telescope Facility, and that's the Canada, France, Hawaii. I think that's the CFHT, a 3.6-meter telescope, as I recall. So that was September 1985. You can see there's Howard Keck. There's Murph Goldberger. That's David Gardner, the president of UC at the time. That's Bill Frazier, who was the chair of the CARA board. Robbie Vogt was the vice chair, was not in Hawaii at this time. And this is Albert Simone, who was the president of the University of Hawaii. So that was the groundbreaking. Here's a few years later when Howard Keck was a very much a hands-on guy. He really wanted to help, but he did not get in the way. He was not telling us what to do, but he wanted to help. And that meant he wanted to see what was happening. So you can see it looks pretty dirty because it's just a lot of steel being welded together to make the dome. And there's the telescope now in place. This is a fisheye view, so it's a little bit distorted, but you can see here's the prime focus up here at the top, the large mirrors down here at the base. It was August 1987 let me make sure I got the right date. 1989. So this was 4 years after we started. The telescope was in place. We were getting ready to start installing some mirrors. And Howard Keck invited Tom Everhart and I to lunch to talk about the idea of why not the second telescope. Talk about bold, right? We hadn't even finished the first one. And Howard Keck was suggesting, what would it take? How would we do this? And so again, in that time, sort of my job was to see how could we put something together like this? We needed to have first light, right? That was clear before anything could happen on Keck 2. And we needed to find a third partner because this was going to be another 80% grant. And Caltech was already in hock for the first one, the 20%. So here was another one. And so that required looking for a third partner. Fortunately, timing is really very important in this business. As Jim said, timing was important for the Keck Foundation because they had just sold Superior Oil. So it was possible for them to make this kind of grant at that time. It turned out that NASA had been looking at what called TOPS, program for other planetary systems, towards other planetary systems, and interferometry was part of that. And they were interested in the technology of interferometry and agreed to be a 1/6 partner in both Keck 1 and Keck 2. The only, again, constraint was, and the money would come after you finished Keck 2. Right? So another opportunity for Caltech. Fortunately, the Caltech board we had first light with 9 segments. You might say, why 9 out of 36? Well, 9 is the same area as Palomar. So with 9 segments, we had a telescope with the same area as Palomar. We had our first light in November of 1990. And December of 1990, the Caltech board approved with a letter that I got from Len Fisk, who was the associate administrator of NASA, saying, yes, and NASA was interested in doing this. Our board said, fine, we will do it. So that's what I call bold. And a week later, the foundation said, we will sign up and do it. It's amazing. It's really quite remarkable when you look back at it, at how important these decisions were. A year later, we had all 36 segments in, and we could dedicate Keck 1. We did that in November of 1991. This is at the dinner. You can see the small model that was given to Howard Keck. This was the dedication of Keck 1. Was actually emceed by Walter Cronkite and Tom Everhart, giving Howard the memento. And here is the groundbreaking. We had the groundbreaking for Keck 2 at the same time, November of 1991. And you can see many of the same players, including Howard in the middle, and this time with OO sticks. We had become culturally more aware about the fact we were using a native Hawaiian mountaintop. And there they are, the two Keck telescopes. We dedicated Keck 2 in the May of 1996. Unfortunately, Howard could not be there at that time. He was no longer very well, could not travel, and Robert Day was the new president of the foundation at the time. But we did set up a satellite video link so Howard could see the dedication of Keck 2, because again, without Howard, we would not have had one or two. So one other thing, though. That wasn't the last thing. It turned out that another timing was very fortunate. That is, the military had been developing adaptive optics to correct for atmospheric aberrations. It was all highly classified. It was all declassified in the early 90s, about the time we were starting Keck 2. And it turned out that, so we put together a plan, a proposal. Claire Max at Lawrence Livermore Lab, which had been working on this technology, was part of that, a proposal for a plan for a laser guide star for Keck 2. And so I had that plan available, and I had been talking to the foundation about it, and when it turned out, we were lucky enough that, in fact, the rate of inflation, it did not go up during the 90s. We actually saved money building Keck 2, and one return for that was the foundation said they would fund the adaptive optics for Keck 2. So again, timing was really very important for us, but again, also the boldness of making a decision, because this again was a new, this was the first. It was the, we had our first light in 2001, the first light of a laser guide star for a large telescope. So now I'd like to just show you the movie. It's a wonderful little movie we made for the dedication, and you'll see first movie has to do with the construction of the dome, if you like. Then there's a time-lapse movie, and finally, the construction of the telescope.
What follows is the story of the construction of the W.M. Keck Observatory and Telescope, told in pictures, sound, and music, a compilation of elements representing over 6 years of photography.
Thank you.
case, bold initiatives, that's what Caltech is about, that's what the Keck Foundation is about, and the observatory is certainly about doing bold science. We're going to hear a sampling of that this afternoon, so thank you very much.